So continuing our focus on the pragmatic real-world solutions for getting things done, it's my pleasure to introduce the former governor of Puerto Rico and the current partner, a current partner at Steptoe & Johnson, Luis Fortuño. During his time as governor of Puerto Rico, he actually did all of these things that we're talking about here today, not just pieces of it, but really did kind of all of them, really created the rules, the tools, and the institutions that were highlighted in that past panel discussion. He moved path-breaking P3 legislation through his legislature. He created a dedicated P3 advisory unit, took substantive steps to rebuild Puerto Rico's infrastructure assets, including its airport, schools, and highways. We're very lucky to have him here for us today and to share his perspectives. As mentioned, he's got to catch a plane internationally, so we really appreciate his time. Please join me in welcoming Governor Fortuño.
Well, thank you, Rob, and certainly I commend you and Bruce and Brookings for putting together this conference, and I want to thank my colleagues in the previous panel for their lively discussion. Indeed, as Rob mentioned earlier this morning, the World Economic Forum has stated that we as a country have fallen behind, and actually in terms of our infrastructure now, ours is considered to be the 25th best infrastructure in the world. It should be the best, and we would think that it ought to be the best. We were talking earlier about the fact that we're a wealthy country. So what's going on and what can we expect? Actually, last year, the American Society of Civil Engineers did a study and stated that in order to bring our infrastructure up to par, in the next 5 years, we will need to invest $2 trillion. That's $1.4 trillion more than we invested in the previous 5 years. So obviously we have an issue here because, as they call it, the new normal is that there is no money coming from Washington, and actually even the states are facing serious fiscal problems. And all that deferred maintenance and underinvestment is eroding our nation's competitiveness. It affects our economy, and it's costing us jobs at the end. That's the bottom line here. And as a result of that, we see that the states are taking a leading role in moving forward and looking for opportunities and other ways to finance and modernize our infrastructure. There is plenty of capital out there, and it is looking for opportunities to get used. We just need to provide the proper vehicles for that money to come in here and be used properly. Because we all know, as we see it in the morning and in the afternoon in our cars, we need more and better expressways and mass transportation systems. We need better schools, courthouses, airports. I travel a little bit and around the country, and I can tell you that when you travel abroad and you look at many of our airports, it is shameful, the state of our airports. And so there is a way to design, finance, build, and operate and maintain this infrastructure in a much better way. And actually, it doesn't have to stop there. Why not do correctional facilities, police stations, water and energy projects, medical facilities, as British Columbia has done? And I'd like to share with you briefly what I call best practices in setting up a program like this. And I must say that when we looked around 4.5 years ago, we looked around the country and we truly could not find in any of the 50 states those best practices. So we looked elsewhere. We looked to Canada, Australia, and the UK mostly. And one of the things we needed to do right away is create a proper and modern legal framework for this to operate. Many of the states are moving, some states are moving in the right direction, but as Rob showed us earlier, most states do not have that modern, proper legal framework to operate on. Otherwise, the money will not come in. Secondly, a dedicated P3 authority makes all the sense in the world, and we learned this from Canada. And it should, that authority should protect the public interest. And there's a common mistake in many, some of the states are moving in this direction, is that they approve some sort of P3 legislation. They just dump on the Department of Transportation at the state level this responsibility with no other guidelines. And that will be a mistake. They requires guidelines, and it requires an authority or semi-independent authority. That authority must also monitor the progress towards specific benchmarks. This cannot be left out there wing in the air. And it should become the single point of contact with the investors. You do not want those investors to be jumping around to different government agencies. Third, you need proper staff, and we saw here why that's important, and we saw some excellent examples of that. Not just officials, government officials, but proper consultants that not just have the expertise, but the entrepreneurial disposition to accomplish these goals. Fourth, and I could not underscore this one more, transparency. There must be full transparency in these processes. Actually, the way we did it in Puerto Rico is that everything was on the internet all the time. Actually, there was an information overload. But that's the way to do it. So anyone at any level can access all documents. There's nothing confidential about any of these transactions. We're talking about the public will. Fifth, different projects. Be focused on projects that can be financed. Not every project can be financed. And there was an excellent question earlier as to different modes to finance projects, but it must be financed. Six, you must have an aggressive schedule to close and stick to it. The worst thing you could do is just keep kicking the can down the road and not close the deals. And actually, Ari reminded me this morning, last year at a conference in Puerto Rico on P3s, that I said, I start projects and I close the deals. I'm here to close the deals. Perhaps my professional training had something to do with that. I'm a transactional lawyer, but that's what I insisted on our P3 authority to do, to close the deals. Seventh, that authority must be totally insulated from politics. And we saw excellent examples in the earlier panel. The way we did it is that we had a board, and actually a board is an excellent idea. And I'm reminded of what happened in Pennsylvania with the highway transaction that never closed. Throwing this back at the state legislature will be a major mistake. Oftentimes, constitutionally, you need the authorization by the legislature. The way we did it was the Speaker of the House at the state level and the President of the Senate suggested each three names, and I picked one of those three in each case to be part of this five-member board. And actually, all final decisions had to be made by unanimous consent of that board. And otherwise, the transaction will not go forward. Eighth, all projects you deal with must deliver a public benefit. And here I'd like, if I may, briefly touch upon something that I'm seeing. I hear about some states having unsolicited tenders. It is public officials that should decide in that dialogue what the public benefit of each transaction should be. Unsolicited tenders make no sense. Number one, because God knows what the public benefit is. But secondly, if you really want the best and the brightest with the deepest pockets and the most experience to compete in your project, do you think they'll invest millions of dollars to compete and put forth a proposal on a transaction that may never happen? It simply makes no sense. And finally, there must be the political will. And actually, in my case, I followed up every 2 weeks to understand where each transaction was. I didn't care to know who the specific players were. I would find out 2 hours before the rest of the public would. But I did care about the process. to make sure that the process was moving forward. And that was key, because that provided certainty to the investors that they knew that if they went down to Puerto Rico to compete, as in any other state or province, that the transaction will take place, and it would not be years from now, it will be when we said they would be, the transaction would close. Actually, I remember the last transaction was the airport, and they informed me that they were going to push back the date for the final decision 2 weeks. And I jumped off my seat and said, no way, unless the finalists unanimously decide that they are all in agreement in having 2 extra weeks, and they decided they wanted, they could use the 2 extra weeks. And I said, okay, if that's what they want, that's fine with us. But I don't want the marketplace to get the wrong impression. I'll close with the following, if I may. And that's why, again, Rob and everyone here at Brookings, I commend you for the leadership you're taking in this issue. If we look around the world, we're competing for jobs that today could be here and tomorrow could be elsewhere. At every level, technical level. In terms of infrastructure determines to a great degree, in addition to the education of our people, determines whether we are going to be competitive or not in the next decade. Each China and India announced recently that in the next 5 years, they'll be investing over $1 trillion in their infrastructure. Brazil announced that they will be investing over $900 billion. So why can't the U.S. rise up to that challenge to improve our quality of life, to make us more competitive, and to create jobs here in America? Thank you, and God bless you all.